Space is the final frontier. And there is an arms race for the control of the cosmos. Russia, China, India, and the US have already deployed ground-based missiles to attack satellites. The Royal Australian Air Force is on their tail.
We're probably about 3 or 4 years behind where I would rather be, but we're catching up quickly.
The greatest current threat to Australia's national security comes from cyber attacks.
If anything, the threat is just getting more frequent, more sophisticated, more complex.
The service has come a long way in 100 years, from the fragile canvas and wooden-framed planes to artificial intelligence in unmanned combat drones. And inventing new rockets.
We're very much just starting developing, you know, space as a what we call a warfighting domain.
As the service marks its centenary, we look at how the Air Force has evolved from an outfit with more planes than men to a modern military organisation. The history of the RAAF is one of endeavour, heroism and courage in war and peace. Serious accountability questions over notorious budget blowouts.
$2,000 million makes this the biggest single item of defence expenditure in Australian history.
And for its, at times, terrible safety record.
Hell, I was so fortunate. And best of all, I survived.
I was the first chief who didn't have a fatal accident on his watch.
The modern Air Force leadership wants to be more about its people than the planes. Now a new generation of recruits aspire to become warriors of the sky.
I've always wanted to do a job that would enable me to serve my country and make a difference in the world.
While women now fly fighter jets, there has been a lot of resistance along the way.
I made my first radio call, and the thing I got back was the air traffic control going, oh, another empty kitchen.
He said, Tracy, don't be so stupid. Their tits will sag and their wombs will fall out under high G. And I was like, sir, really, that's ridiculous.
But no one is unchanged by their service.
A diagnosis of PTSD filled me with shame. I thought I should be stronger than this.
From the maelstrom of war to humanitarian missions, a career in the RAAF could take you anywhere. One of the greatest mysteries surrounding the Air Force is why there are so many mustaches. There is no doubt the Air Force is a family affair.
My pop was in the RAAF, my dad was in the RAAF, I'm in the RAAF, and now my kid goes to Little Eagles.
Some veterans share a special connection.
My birthday is the same as the RAAF, the 31st of March. 1921.
For the last 100 years, the RAAF has lived up to its Latin motto, per adua ad astra, through adversity to the stars.
Burn your name right across the sky, so I never forget what the feeling's like. Burn your name right across the sky, so I never forget what the feeling's like.
During World War I, aeroplanes appeared in the sky as weapons of war. Initially for the observation of enemy movements, they were soon armed with machine guns and bombs. Fighter pilots, the jousting knights of the modern age. Military aviation had come of age. The Australian airmen were larrikins, They flew with daring and dash, but life expectancy of man and machine was brutal and short. One third of all pilots were killed. The decisive role of air power in the closing stages of the war demonstrated the need for an Australian Air Force. It was made official on March 31st, 1921. Great Britain donated more than 120 planes to the fledgling service, but in its early days, the RAAF had more aircraft than men. Richard Dickey Williams became the first chief of the service.
Our continent is a vast and valuable one, and its defence calls for the highest efficiency in the small forces which we maintain. Let us show you how the Royal Australian Air Force sets about its part of the task.
The Air Force still uses dazzling displays of aerial aerobatics to drive recruitment.
You can't be what you haven't seen. And seeing us as the roulettes being out and about at air shows, I think, is really important.
Stunts aside, the Air Force had a shocking safety record. A lack of discipline, poor training, and simple pilot error led to many crashes.
All right, gentlemen, break off and carry on with the program.
As World War II loomed, the RAAF was a weak and ineffective fighting force, and most combat planes were obsolete.
The majority of the aircraft we were flying at the time were a generation, at least a generation, possibly two generations behind more contemporary aircraft that were coming out of Europe and the UK at the time.
At Kingsford Smith Aerodrome Mascot, the Minister for Civil Aviation, Mr. Fairbairn, tells trainees of the vast new empire plan of which they are part.
This war will be won by air power.
Australia is in peril of bombing attack. Your home, you yourself, are in danger as a result of air assault that may come at any time. This is the warning sound, an undulating wail. When you hear it in reality, put on slippers or shoes. Have your torch handy. Wrap the children warmly before moving them to shelter.
As the prospect of war became a reality, the shortcomings of the Air Force became all too apparent. Massed air armadas haunted defence planners. The Allies badly underestimated the strength of Japanese air power. The emerging Australian aircraft industry simply couldn't build enough modern combat planes. Local design and production started with the Wirraway.
Here on the tarmac, outside the Commonwealth Aircraft Corporation's factory, is an Australian-made Wirraway, a trainer, fighter, bomber designed by Australian experts, made by Australian workmen from Australian materials.
They were simply no match for the Japanese Zeros.
Let's say goodbye with a smile, dear.
To be a member of an air crew was one of the most dangerous callings of the war.
More and more men of this splendid type are required for air crew. It's a grand service that asks for the flower of our youth and gets it. Here are 150 raw recruits enlisted only an hour before the march.
Tens of thousands of Australian air and ground crew fought in all theatres of war, from the Western Desert and North Africa to the Spitfire squadrons in England.
August 8th, 1940. That was the day the Luftwaffe opened phase one of Germany's plan to invade the British Isles, but which ended nearly 3 months later as a major victory for the handful of men and boys flying British Hurricanes and Spitfires. That handful included pilots from Australia who accounted for many of the 2,375 enemy machines destroyed.
The reality of war led to significant social change. Women were for the first time recruited to free up more men for the war effort. The Women's Auxiliary Australian Air Force was formed in March 1941. Smiling through, just like you. Fighting initial prejudice, women served in roles on the home front as mechanics, radar operators, electricians, and drivers, although they wouldn't be able to fly fighter jets until 1988. The recruitment drive was a little intense.
The Women's Auxiliary Air Force has given me a new interest in life, an entirely different outlook, and has supplied the answer to a question. It is a haunting question, you know. Are you in a war job? Are you?
Look at these new recruits. Notice their hesitating and lackadaisical manner? The way they seem to flop about. They have no idea of doing the same thing at the same time, nor even of all turning the same way.
All too soon you'd hear this strident voice. Come on, you lot, out on the parade ground. Don't stand around like a lot of country dunnies.
The men of the RAAF had always been praised for their marching and their immaculate turnout. But you can see that the women upheld their standards. We felt we were rather super.
The WAF would play a crucial role in the war effort.
Girls of the WAF are expert in maintenance work. It takes a crew of 45 to give a plane full inspection over a period of 12 hours. 1,200 people work constantly on the planes at this vast station.
On the front line, it was an endless cycle of sorties, sacrifice, and slaughter.
There were times when I felt I'd never be able to get into an aeroplane again. When we went through fairly severe combats, my morale was pretty low. I kept going, but I started dreaming at night. And I got to the stage where I would wake up just as I was about to hit the ground in flames, and I'd be screaming.
All bang on, just everything's bang on, sir.
It was in the skies over Europe where thousands of aircrew lost their lives. Australian crews were part of the Royal Air Force Bomber Command, a multinational force targeting Nazi Germany. The losses were so heavy. Statistically, a man had very little chance of survival. One in three Australian aircrew were killed. A tour of duty in Bomber Command had a higher death rate than the rats of Tobruk or on the Kokoda track.
The first and most significant reason is that they were endeavouring to operate or conduct an air campaign when they hadn't achieved the single most important rule of any air campaign, and that is you must have control of the air.
Right, well, you all know the target. It's Berlin, once more. 0 hour is 0315. Now, from A down to B is no trouble, quite straightforward, but make sure that you are south of Bremen and that you are north of Hanover. Has anybody got any questions? Okay, well, that's all. Have a good trip.
The Allies were hoping to destroy Germany's war economy and undermine their morale with a relentless aerial bombing campaign. But it came at a shocking cost. The carpet bombing of Germany introduced the concept of total war. The homes of workers in industrial areas became military targets. The combat zone was now people's homes. Millions were caught up in the conflagration.
The scene then fairly clubbed the mind. There was just a mass of fire below, an inferno, and the flak bursting above you and around you. If it was very close, you heard it, but all this was like a silent film. We were so high that we never saw a person. And it was very difficult when you were terrified yourself and you had a load of bombs on, it was very difficult to relate to those who were suffering from the falling of your bombs and the tremendous damage that was being done. It was terribly impersonal. I remind myself just how frightful Nazism was.
Bomber Command left a controversial legacy, but no one doubted the bravery of those men flying almost suicidal missions.
It's staggering to me that people who must have known what the attrition rate was like to constantly volunteer, effectively, to go on and on and on and risk their lives daily. I think it's absolutely staggering. It's part of the characteristic of the Australians, I think. I can do better than anybody else.
Most Australian airmen served in the contingent that was known as No. 460 Squadron. They flew more sorties and dropped more bomb tonnage than any other squadron. But the losses were enormous. The 200 men that made up the contingent at any one time were lost five times over during the war. G for George was an incredibly special bomber. It flew over 80 missions when most operational bombers were shot down before they reached 20 sorties. It had the distinction of bringing home alive every crewman who flew aboard her. Upon retirement from combat duty, she was flown to Australia by an all RAAF crew.
Veteran Lancaster bomber G for George lands at B for Brisbane in a D for dust storm. But what's a dust storm to G for George? Storms of hot metal when the flak was furious over Berlin are nothing new to this famous Lancaster.
It now has pride of place in the Australian War Memorial, a striking memory to the 3,486 Australian men who lost their lives in Bomber Command. There were so many stories of heroism that pilot Rawdon Middleton stands out for his gallantry and was awarded the Victoria Cross. On a mission over Italy, his bomber was hit by anti-aircraft fire and he suffered shrapnel wounds to his arms, legs and body. His right eye was ripped out of its socket. For 4 hours, he struggled to fly his stricken bomber home, almost blind and mortally wounded. As they approached the English coast, he ordered his crewmates to bail out before he ditched the plane into the channel.
When he realised that they were all gone down safely, he turned the aircraft around and went straight back out and crashed into the sea. It's sad, isn't it?
Pilots like Middleton were facing the same challenges in the Pacific. Japan was taking advantage of Hitler's war in Europe to advance its own ambitions in the Far East. Following the bombing of Pearl Harbor, the Japanese Imperial Army stormed Singapore. It was the greatest military defeat in the history of the British Empire. It was one of the darkest days in Australia's wartime history, and the government made the dramatic decision to pull resources from the European theatre of war to defend the homeland. The invasion of Australia appeared imminent as we became the target of Japanese attacks. Just 4 days after the fall of Singapore, the first devastating air raids on Australian soil occurred when a wave of Japanese bomber planes shelled Darwin, killing more than 250 people, destroying the port, 9 ships, and more than 20 aircraft.
The war was on our northern doorstep. It was a rude awakening to Australians.
There was a virtual media blackout on the extent of the damage, but there was also a cover-up of the reports of looting and mass desertions by the Air Force in the wake of the bombings.
Here is an undertaking of which every Australian should be intensely proud. Where 3 years ago, a country which did not produce even a motorcycle is today making a modern torpedo bomber.
But the rush to meet the demands of the war machine came at a terrible toll. The loss of man and machine is the cost of war. But the RAAF was losing many young pilots in training accidents. In East Sale, the training base became known as Death Valley. 190 young men lost their lives.
A horrendous loss rate of wonderful young people. I might add that there were more accidents in training in Australia and more people lost than were lost on combat operations in the Southwest Pacific.
Outgunned and outmaneuvered by the Japanese planes, the RAAF initially struggled, despite the bravado broadcast on the home front.
She's the first bomber shot down over Australia by a night fighter, and she fell to the guns of squadron leader R.C. Creswell. 9 Japanese were in the machine. All were killed. Squadron leader Creswell is in a bit of a lather about it, and with double justification. It was his first combat, and he broke the ice with a big one. When he comes out from behind the camouflage, he looks like this. Attaboy, Creswell. Another day of hard work and high adventure. And it's a fine day for killing, says nonchalant, hard-boiled Wing Commander B.R. Blackjack Walker of Adelaide.
It seemed nothing would stop Japan's inexorable march towards the Australian mainland. But the arrival of US Kitty Hawks and British Spitfires gave inexperienced Aussie pilots the machinery they needed to finally take control of the air.
Today they make practice sorties over desert and sea. Tomorrow they'll be fully trained to join the 7,000 RAAF flyers already in action against the Jap, just as experienced in heavy bombing as the 16,000 Australian airmen who fight over Germany.
The battle for Milne Bay in Papua New Guinea was a major turning point in the war.
No praise is too high for the magnificent work of the RAAF Kitty Hawk fighter squadrons. Men back from Milne Bay say that the fighter pilots' contribution to the success of the operation was incalculable.
As the island-hopping Allies advanced in the Pacific, the RAAF airfield construction teams built landing strips on island after island. The change wrought by war saw many advances. Len Waters became the first and only known Indigenous fighter pilot during the war. He achieved the almost unthinkable, flying an elite fighter, Kitty Hawk, named Black Magic.
Oh, they were unreal. They were. Like, I mean, they didn't have the same power as a Spitfire or a Mustang or a Thunderbolt, but we actually had the best record against the Japs.
Len Waters was the first Aboriginal pilot in World War II. He was indeed a hero to us, and particularly as we've looked back over time and his story and the hardships that he made to be where he was, and to then go back to country and help in every way. There are stories of hardship after he served, but again, that's what we encountered after some of us had left the services in that time.
The war would drag on for another 3 years. Then on the 6th of August, 1945, the US dropped the world's first atomic bomb on the Japanese city of Hiroshima, obliterating the city and instantly killing more than 100,000 people. The war had come to an abrupt end. For many pilots, it took time to get home. The RAAF was also involved in transporting the victims of the Holocaust. The RAAF had developed into a credible and sophisticated air force, and at the end of the war, it was the fourth largest in the world. But in the post-war years, most of the air force returned to civilian life to help rebuild the country and their lives. While some believe the Royal Australian Air Force really came of age as a fighting force in the Second World War, the next 75 years would see the service shift from direct combat to peacetime efforts and humanitarian relief.
Air power is peace power, and the RAAF is ready from the ground up. It's shown that fangs in wartime. Young men in time of peace are keeping it prepared.
The Korean War between the US-backed South Koreans and the Communist North was the first major conflict of the Cold War.
And now it's the turn of 77 Squadron, Australian Air Force, to take the air and be in the blue, as they would say in Australianese. And what a blue it is. Actual action, the 77 Squadron's brilliant leader, Wing Commander Lew Spence, was shot down and killed.
35 pilots were killed in action in Korea. There were skirmishes all over our region, including in Malaya.
Bombs are for the red bandits in the jungle. This is another Australian contribution in the Cold War, although it seldom hits the headlines.
One campaign that always made headlines was the Vietnam War. Much was written about the war. It was controversial at home and deeply complex abroad.
And it has been reported that there's heavy concentrations there and light ground fire.
Number 2 Squadron mounted strikes against Viet Cong targets.
For 3.5 years, we never lost an aircraft. And that was pretty amazing. A similar type of aircraft to ours, the American B-57, which was based on the Canberra, they lost so many that when those pilots became members of our officers' mess and came down for a drink, we wondered how long they would last.
While dissent raged in Australia, the air war in Vietnam brought forward the professionalism of the RAAF. 14 airmen were killed.
I don't believe we suffered the sorts of trauma that so many in the army suffered, not just for coming home. The nature of our duty in Vietnam was so different to what the army went through. So it's very difficult to, even for me, to even understand what they went through.
As I report to you, air attacks are underway against military targets in Iraq.
Australian forces were deployed to Iraq in 1991, but never engaged in open combat with hostile forces during the Gulf War. In 2003, Hornets were used to attack Iraqi forces with laser-guided bombs during the Second Iraq War. As the conflict went on, Hercules transporters flew supplies and equipment into the war-torn country, and P-3 Orions were also deployed to the Middle East to support the coalition fleet with surveillance operations in the Persian Gulf. It's impossible to eliminate stress in combat or in peacetime missions. Anywhere and at any time, the RAAF could be deployed to disaster zones. Darkness, I'll leave for a place I've never seen. It's been calling out to me, that is where I should be.
Hercules aircraft of the Royal Australian Air Force, laden with relief supplies, were on their way to Fiji immediately help was requested. The C-130s brought in urgently needed tents and blankets for the homeless, and 2,000 portable water tanks, for Fiji's main water system was polluted.
The RAAF has extensive involvement in UN peacekeeping operations, deploying aircraft to Sinai and Pakistan, ground units to Cambodia, Somalia, and in the wake of the genocide in Rwanda.
kids being having stepped on mines or having been hacked, or the after effects of being hacked by machetes. And there was one particular case, a little orphan called Sabarina. She was about 2 years old. She became very, very unwell. She was an orphan, so we were worried that, you know, she, if she recovered from the encephalitis, she may have brain damage. Having brain damage in a country like Rwanda, being an orphan, really wasn't necessarily a very good prognosis. So had to come to that decision, well-reasoned decision, that we would let her pass. They still tried to resuscitate her. So a lot of tears. I saw the nuns coming up the corridor and I thought, okay, so I've been able to counsel other people. These nuns are the best people in the world. They're there to counsel me. And when I told the nun what had happened, she burst into tears.
The dawn of democracy in Timor triggered a humanitarian crisis. Armed militia opposed to independence went on a murderous rampage backed by the powerful Indonesian military. In response, Australia launched its largest military deployment since the Vietnam War, pushing Canberra and Jakarta to the very brink of a major confrontation.
If Australia comes to Indonesia, we will fight with you.
A dozen RAAF C-130 Hercules transport planes, with fighter jets on standby in Darwin to act as a deterrent.
I could see where I was making a difference. And I will admit, I got more from the East Timorese. They taught me so much about faith and resilience and the ability to overcome adversity. They were very proud of what they had achieved.
Sharon's second tour of duty in East Timor was nearly her last.
I was involved in a very serious helicopter crash. In clinical terms, a burst wedge compression fracture of L3. I broke my jaw in four places and I had aviation fuel burns to my neck and shoulders and my back.
Both Tracy and Sharon suffered in the wake of their deployments.
A lot of my compatriots, you know, did still suffer to this day from their experiences in Rwanda. A lot of the ethical and moral dilemmas, I think, are a big part of that. I found it difficult initially when I got back as well, but it's important to understand that being resilient isn't just about, you know, just soldiering on, if you like. It's also about knowing where your limits are and asking for help if you need it.
I love to talk now about post-traumatic growth rather than talk about PTSD, because whilst we've increased the mental health literacy around PTSD, very few people talk about post-traumatic growth. So I love to talk about my life after trauma, my ability to continue to live beyond trauma, and my, you know, solid belief that everyone has the capability to do that.
I'd love to be able to find a way to get everybody to understand that PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, is not inevitable from trauma. So trauma is not a one-way ticket to PTSD. If you're able to recognise that you need help, do something about it, you know, put up your hand, then you can have a different trajectory.
But sometimes the trauma runs too deep, even 80 years later.
I try to forget it because it only evokes memories I would hope wouldn't fade away.
Whilst we're still seeing rates of mental health illness and suicide amongst our veteran population, we're still not doing enough. We must continue to listen to our veterans. We must continue to learn from their experiences.
Bali's main hospital was overwhelmed by the numbers, and as the death toll doubled and redoubled, body bags began lining surrounding alleyways.
During some of Australia's most traumatic moments, the RAAF has been there.
The medicos, we're just going over to have a look what's on the ground and what sort of resources we need.
The Air Force also plays a role in disaster relief at home.
In times of natural disasters, animals suffer as much as humans. And much Australian livestock has been saved by RAAF Haydrop operations.
More recently, they played a major role in the deadly summer bushfires across three states in early 2020.
Flying in is actually quite terrifying. The countryside is purely black, and as you look around, it's burnt right up to the airfield, right up to the town. So the guys here have had a very rough time.
The RAAF set up a mobile airfield.
That facility allowed us to continue that operation at the high standard that was required. Even just the simple thing of having air conditioning and being out of the smoke was a godsend. And I was proud to be asked to go and help. It's a fairly unique opportunity, and you know, we're acting in the best interests of our community, which is great to sort of give back.
The most adventurous and lonely task in the Royal Australian Air Force today is done by the officers and airmen of the RAAF's Antarctic flight.
The Air Force first operated in Antarctica back in the 1920s. It was a significantly different challenge in those days. So we're very privileged to have such a capable aircraft and such good equipment to work with in the 2000s.
I was able to jump on and go over to Nepal because they had had an earthquake and the Air Force was packing up all this aid to take over to the citizens of Nepal in Kathmandu. So I helped to load all the pallets up and put it on the plane and then fly over to Nepal with all that cargo and actually offload it and give it to the Nepalese army there and put it on their trucks. So I got to see the whole production line of what my job actually does, and I knew that it was going to help people, so that was really cool.
You gotta give it a little love and honey. If you want a lot of love in return.
The arrival of the jet age revolutionised aviation, but it came with massive budget blowouts and the desperate attempt to stem the loss of planes and personnel that would define the RAAF.
To Australians, the F-111 story is basically one of a hasty and unwise purchase by the Australian government. To Americans, I suppose, it's basically a story of failure within their aircraft industry. But at least the Americans have an aircraft industry.
In 1963, the RAAF agreed to pay more than £100 million for the F-111 while the aircraft was still being designed.
You in Australia will be able to see for the first time most of our two squadrons of F-111s parked here in temporary storage.
The F-111 fighter bomber was beset with long-running technical problems and serious structural issues. It was delayed by 5 years, and the Air Force didn't take delivery until 1973. And by that time, it had cost almost three times its original price tag. For years, Air Force jets had evocative names like the Meteor, the Phantom, Sabre, Vampire, and Mirage. So what did they call the fastest and most potent strike weapon in its arsenal?
We'd always called it the Pig, P-I-G. And the reason being is you have a look at the long snout on it. And we always flew down what we called in the weeds day and night. And it resembled an aardvark with its long nose, with it sniffing around in the dirt for targets and something to eat. So we always called it a pig. It wasn't meant in a derogatory term, it was more or less an engendered term that we liked it.
Despite the cost and delays, it appeared to be highly successful. It was the fastest long-range combat bomber in Southeast Asia. Theoretically, it could fly to Indonesia and deliver its payload on Jakarta and return without refueling. It went twice the speed of sound, but not for long. The wind got so hot, it could melt the windscreen.
Good fun. Good fun.
And in its 40-year service, it never saw active combat.
3, 2, 1.
There is a certain frustration, I must admit. Everybody trains to do a job, but not everybody gets to do it. The pilot is the fighter pilot. Trains to do this, he trains for air combat maneuvering, for dropping bombs, but never gets to things. But I guess that's a saving grace that we don't always do that.
During his takeoff, something happened with the engines. We think they've failed to give power, that is for sure. And he decided to abort. He couldn't stop in the remaining runway length. And as you can see over here, ran off the runway and the crew ejected, and that's their capsule. You can see on the field over there. And the aircraft caught fire when it hit the embankment down there.
If we look back to the 1980s, I think, and the year 1991, through that period, the Australian Defence Force lost 60 aircraft in training accidents, and we had 42 people killed in those accidents. That was an 11-year period. I can remember vividly Air Marshal Les Fisher standing up. He said, "I will not tolerate fatal accidents. I will not tolerate any form of cowboy flying."
4 kilometres from Gaira, emergency services found a crater 5 metres deep and wreckage so fragmented they couldn't identify the F-111.
It's like a firecracker, just like that.
There's no other aircraft in the world that can get down there and touch us, and that's the reason we must do that training, and we do it day in, day out around here.
We lost 8 aeroplanes in all the time we flew them in those 35 or so years. There are only a couple from mechanical failures. The rest were, as best we know, because quite a few were at night, were crew failures. In other words, human factors came into it.
They were training accidents that could have been avoided, and we needed to learn from those and ensure that we took care of our people. And when you look in the eyes of the families of those people, it's inexcusable that we allow these sort of mistakes to happen. So that's why it's so important to us. And I want to take care of every person in the Air Force to make sure that that doesn't happen.
There seems to be a lot of similarities between the F-111 and the F-35, also known as the Joint Strike Fighter. The F-111 was finally phased out because of the prohibitive cost of running it, more than $40,000 an hour. And the Joint Strike Fighter will not be much cheaper, if at all. But it will be safer.
We, of course, went on with the brilliant F-111, and now we've gone on to the Joint Strike Fighter, which I know cops a lot of criticism, but that's probably because people don't understand it is a compromise of capabilities. It can do a whole range of things that none of us ever dreamt of when we were young.
The F-35 Joint Strike Fighter was billed as the most deadly of all fighter planes. Is the JSF really worth the billions of dollars we're set to pay? There's nothing new for Australian taxpayers in ordering up big weapons purchases and then seeing big budget blowouts, big delays, and sometimes big disappointments. The F-35 Joint Strike Fighter could be the granddaddy debacle of them all.
The F-35 is absolutely the best combat aircraft that we could have to achieve that deterrent effect that we need to have, to actually be credible in our military power and to protect all of our other assets on land and sea as well.
So, yes, F-35 is a part of that. It's a key part of the shooting part of it, you know, the delivery of violence on behalf of government if and when it was required. It does provide a strong deterrent value as well. It's expensive, yes, it sure is. But air combat capability is a vital capability for us.
There is a new mantra in the RAAF. Mission first, safety always.
And you're always seeking to minimise risk. We shouldn't go out as Lawrence of Arabia said of one of the Smith brothers, Ross Smith. He comes from a race called Australians who seek out additional risk. We shouldn't be a race that seeks additional risk when we're flying aeroplanes, particularly military aeroplanes.
When I joined the Air Force in the 80s, we had accidents, you know, happen on a really regular basis, and it was just seen as really normal. And, you know, I did a crash investigation as a junior officer, and I remember the air crew being absolutely just so angry with me because we stopped flying so that we could actually fix the aircraft so they didn't have another crash. It was the fourth crash due to the same cause. Now, that just would not happen today. Just a huge cultural shift that we've had. And I was part of that in terms of the airworthiness process. But now, you know, it's mission first, safety always. And everyone knows that. And I think that, you know, from the technician on the floor to the people who are just working around the airfield, everyone understands the importance of aviation safety.
It's the constant training and preparation that makes it possible to survive in hostile environments.
In 2016, I was posted to 33 Squadron flying the KC-30A tanker, and I deployed on Operation Okra for 3.5 months. So I was doing air-to-air refuelling with both our Australian fast jet aircraft and also multiple coalition partners over Iraq. It's something you train your whole career, is to be able to put all of your skills into practice to be able to operate in a hostile environment like that.
But there are simply some situations where it doesn't matter how much training you have.
It was in Afghanistan that I truly came to understand what defence service meant, particularly for the Australian Army and for the soldiers on the ground. I saw fit young men in the prime of their lives, torn to pieces by improvised explosive devices, by gunfire. It really brought home to me the sacrifice that these young men were making in our name. And yeah, I did say I had worn their blood because it had a significant impact on me to be there when they needed me.
The very nature of warfare is changing. Remotely piloted drones can deliver lethal force thousands of kilometres from the combat zone. It was hoped this would protect pilots from the harms of warfare. But instead of being shielded from the psychological and emotional impacts, drone pilots face the risk of moral injury.
It is a psychological challenge, I think, for people to go to war one day and go home to their family at night. And we've really got to do a lot of work to understand how we can best help those people who are in that circumstance where they're going from one environment to a very, very different one and the challenges that faces.
There are also ethical concerns when artificial intelligence is incorporated into our defence system.
Humans always need to help design the machines, and, you know, artificial intelligence is great, but you have to teach it. And generally speaking, we have to use humans to teach it. And I think that that means that there's always a really strong role for humans. Humans need to be in the decision loop. Humans need to make those ethical decisions.
And I think somewhere in the endeavour of conflict, which is about human will, you'll always need human interaction. You'll need humans in the loop to be able to make these some very difficult decisions in terms of what we might need to do in combat or in conflict to resolve an issue as required by our governments.
Software is a key component in nearly every critical system used by the Air Force, and attacking the software in the system is a revolutionary method of pursuing war.
If your system is compromised and what have you, you don't necessarily know for sure what the adversary has done in the first instance. Right? So they may have stolen the information, they may have manipulated it to undermine the integrity of the information, or they may have just simply seek to preserve the access unto a later date. When you come to recover, the challenge is you firstly need to make sure the adversary is out of your system. If you just recover integrity and the adversary is still in your system, you're going to be no better off because they'll still be able to undermine your data.
External threats are a constant challenge, but the strength of the force remains its people.
The family element to the Defence Force is definitely a thing. When the going gets tough, we band together and get the job done.
And it's not just those serving.
I take my hat off. There should actually be more recognition to the families or the partners, the wives, the spouses. They should get better recognition for their endurance that they put up with. Like when we're deployed at short notice, we're called to go flying. They're the ones left to hold the pieces together in the family unit while you're off doing your job.
Hey, mate.
How are you?
Good to see you.
Dropping in for
good
a bit
to
of
see
a
you. Not as a patient this time.
Yeah.
The force is full of trailblazers.
I really didn't come out until the mid-90s. That's when I, you know, came to the realisation, I suppose. And by then, we had the, really great leadership from the federal government to take away that barrier that said LGBT plus people couldn't serve in the military. You know, we were the first in the Western militaries to do that, which is makes me quite proud as an Australian.
The RAAF has also launched a new strategy to improve Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander participation and inclusion.
I believe the Air Force has been at the forefront for embracing the enlistment of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people in every way to help them to sort of come on board and settle into a career.
I was actually lucky enough to be a part of the Defence Indigenous Pre-Recruit Program. Recruits get to really learn about the history of Indigenous Australia as well as dig a bit deeper into their own Indigenous heritage.
Some that serve will have fabulous ambitions.
No, I didn't save the world. I often say that I set out to save the world one person at a time. So I like to reflect on the difference that I made in individual lives, and the ripple effect of that is that hopefully those people have gone out and played their part in saving the world and making it a better place.
The next generation will define the future of the force.
Now is my opportunity to give back to those girls that are coming through and mentor them and just be that sounding board, be that person that they can come and have a chat to when maybe they are finding that the flying is stressful or things aren't what they expected.
I decided to join the Air Force as I'm a bit of an aviation nerd.
I see this as an exciting opportunity to have a respectable and a reliable career that offers a world of opportunities to grow.
The reason I joined the Air Force was to really set myself up with a lifelong career, as well as continue the tradition of military service that runs my family from my great-great-grandfather now down to myself.
It's been hard, but it's been amazing at the same time.
Baby, don't hate my mustache. Come on now, give it a try.
It remains to be seen how many of the new recruits will follow in the RAAF tradition of a good old-fashioned mustache.
I had a moustache for a while, but that was more of a fad in the 70s.
I do remember some people with old grey moustaches, full of nicotine.
I won't grow a moustache. I have tried.
Much simpler to have a good shave.
No, I don't look good with a moustache.
While the future of the Air Force will be shaped by the pioneers of the past, The next 100 years will be determined by how the RAAF confronts the constant challenges of an evolving digital world. For now, it's time to reflect on a century of service and the battle to stay relevant in modern aerial warfare. For one veteran, he's looking forward to sharing his milestone celebrations.
Wonderful things in store. I'm being picked up and I'm going to be taken to meet the governor, and there's a flight past. What more could you want?
Wings over Australia. Wings shaped tenderly, firmly. Australian eagles soaring into the Australian sky. Australian planes, their engines roaring a proud sound. From the Airmen's Valhalla, they see Australian youth, glorious in its courage, magnificent in its daring, blazoning to the world their challenge. These machines, these men who fly them, form the Commonwealth's first line of defense. Upon them, the spirit of our nation aspires.